The Fall of the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies. We will go together through this important piece of Italian history to explain the reason and the foundation of the Italian immigration to the United States. Immigration, of course, that happened at the end of 1800s and beginning of 1900s. So let's start to understand what exactly created the basis for this immigration from this important phenomena. So we had in 1860 seven different states that were part of Italy. So the Italian territory was not just one single country, but was split in seven states. And so these seven states were basically founded in one single country after a quick war that was called the Risorgimento. And this war was led by the Kingdom of Sardinia, also called King of Piemont, that basically invaded with a very quick campaign of wars the other states without a declaration of war and unified all the Italian territory under his name. But after this unification, we have that we faced two big waves of immigration from Italy to the rest of the world, and in particular to the United States, above all in the second period. In the first period, we had a lot of immigration from the north of the country. You see more than 3 million of people that went between 1876 and 1900 to South America. Where basically in the second wave, we have more or less the same amount of people from the north and the south, but this time the most of them went to the United States. So we will go together to understand the reason of this. So coming back for a moment to 1860, just some weeks before the invasion from the north. Naples, in that time, had been the capital of a powerful kingdom for more than 800 years. The Kingdom of the South of Italy, so-called Kingdom of Two Sicilies, the Regno delle Due Sicilie in Italian, was founded by Roger of Altaville in 1130 after Christ. And this is the royal palace of this kingdom, from which basically the rulers were governing, administrating all the province of the Kingdom of Two Sicilies for 800 years. The capital, Naples, was one of the most important capital of Europe at the time, and still now is the only city, European city, with five castles in the center city. We had Castel dell'Ovo, Castelnuovo, also called Maschio Angioino, we have Castel Capuana, and we have Castel Sant'Elmo, and we have the remains of the Castle of Carmine that was partially demolished by the Piemontese army. But Naples was also hoisting in her boundaries also five splendid royal palaces. The first one, the main royal palace, was just facing the sea, all the Gulf of Naples, with the splendid gardens on its balcony that you can still admire still now. The palace was surrounded by a big square that still now it's most important to hoist basically events where a lot of people can still be hoisted. Then we have a second royal palace in Quisisana, in Castellammare di Stabia, that was another splendid, even though small, residence on the hills in front of the, on the other, basically, side of the Gulf of Naples, and was giving to the royalties another perspective of the Gulf. And this was also closer to the Roman ruins of Stabia. But one of a very famous royal residence in Naples was the Capodimonte Park and Museum that was built to hoist one of the most important collection of painting of the world. It is still there today. This is called Pinacoteca Farnesiana, and this is still now basically the most incredible collection of paintings. This royal residence has also a big, huge park that still today give a big brief to all the overpopulated city of Naples. Then, of course, we cannot forget to mention the royal palace of Caserta, the so-called Regia of Caserta, a huge, splendid royal palace by which the governors of Naples want basically to compete with the French Versailles. This huge residence was built with more than 3,000 rooms and with a huge park with the shape of a violin, as you can see, with the huge marble stairs, with a park of more than 3.5 kilometers, so with a lot of different kind of gardens, Italian gardens, French garden, English garden, in accordance with the fashion of the time. Still today, you can see a huge, splendid cascades of fountains that from the mountains of Cerino go down until the Royal Palace, bringing the water to the Caserta Royal Palace and neighborhood, and as well also to the capital of Naples. This is some overview on the splendid, magnificent fountains, as well as the Royal English Gardens. The fifth royal residence close to Naples was the Royal Villa of Portici. This royal villa was built by Charles, King of Naples, to stay close to the capital, but just a few kilometers outside the gates of the capital, to have just a sort of a residence where go to rest and relax. This huge residence with a huge park was also conceived to hoist the collection of Roman antiquities that the king was ordering to escape in Pompeii and Herculaneum. As you can see, basically the royal site of Portici was in this position between Naples and Herculaneum and Pompeii, and so was in a good position just outside the gates of the city to hoist this collection and to give to the king and to his guests basically the possibility to relax outside the capital. But Portici was not also the royal villa, but was also hoisting another important achievement of the kingdom, the first railways of the continental Europe, the second in the world after England. This is the painting celebrating the inauguration of the first royal train that was coming from Naples to Portici on a path of 3 kilometers, more or less. And this basically is still the locomotive and the vane that are kept in the museum of the railway still in Portici. And this is a most important achievement because the governors of the Kingdom of Sicily, they didn't want just to build a royal palace. They also wanted to achieve progress and modernization of the country. And each royal residence was, for example, was surrounded by factories that were basically producing the enough supplies to give the life to the royal residences without burden on the royal on the country, basically taxes. We cannot forget that in the Kingdom of Sicily, the people who were farming the lands never paid taxes, and this was one of the things that changed dramatically under the unification of Italy. Just to talk about the modern achievement of the Kingdom of the South of Italy, we can remember the first bridge in steel on Garigliano that is still there after so many, more than two centuries. We remember the first factories of locomotives. We remember also the most important dockyard of Mediterranean in Castellammare di Stabia, where they were building very advanced ships that got the Neapolitan fleet, the second fleet in the Mediterranean after the French one. The governors started to build again aqueduct as in the Roman style after basically so many centuries after the fall of the Roman empires. They also founded the first two observatory in their kind of the world, the Astronomy Observatory in Naples, always in Capodimonte, and the observatory for volcanology close to the Vesuvius. This was the first volcanology observatory, I repeat, of the world. We cannot forget that also in Naples we had a lot of application activities applied to the fashion. We have the famous fabrics in silks of San Leucio, that was just a residence close to the royal site of Caserta, where basically the rulers wanted to have a big factory for silks, as well as they ordered the construction of a big hall for the poor of the kingdom, the Hall of the Miserables, where basically all the poor people from the kingdom were invited to come, where they can find a job as basically manufacturer of fabrics. We cannot forget also the antiquities in Naples. As I said before, the King Charles started the excavation in the Roman ruins of Pompeii and Herculaneum, and this was bringing to the kingdom a lot of tourism to see these antiquities. Also was for severely forbidden to draw, only to make drawings of these antiquities, because the tourist had to come there to see all the antiquities. And also, starting from the Roman fashions for the Roman taste for decoration, they developed the Capodimonte porcelain factory, where basically they're still creating today this wonderful composition of flowers that are manufactured with a secret formula of porcelain that cannot be still today manufactured and utilized outside the city of Naples. You can see on this other side also the manufacturing of corals and cameos, that was also a tradition, a Roman tradition, that were still basically kept and, if it's possible, promoted and restored in Naples by the government to try also to have something very unique in the world. And move back for a moment to our history. So basically I talked about a few weeks before the invasion, 1860, but let's go just 30 years before. Other 30 years before, in 1832, the 21st of November, we had the royal wedding between Maria Cristina of Piemont of Sardinia and the King of Naples, the King of Two Sicilies, Ferdinand II. They would have had very soon a single son, Francis II, that he would have been the last king of Two Sicilies. But at the time, no one could predict these ends, because basically all the Italy was very settled in a very peace situation. The king of Sardinia has married all his four girls with all princes of Italy. And so through this marriage bonding, basically, they've created a very peaceful status of Italy. And no one was predicting the ends. Also, the king tried many times to convince the European nations to have the permission to leave to one of her, basically, girls, his kingdom. And so, basically, to start to keep this status, the status quo in Italy. But the European nations prevented by many European disposition and Congress that the king was able to change the succession rule. And so basically this put the seed for basically a big upheaval after 30 years. Before I go on, I just want to notice to you that it's a chance of course, of the coincidence of history, but just 3 days before this royal wedding, also my ancestors, Antonio Noncito and Maria Ceraulo, got married. And so this is just an example, of course, during this history of the great people, there are also the history of the small people that still, of course, live, and sometimes they have the event very close in connection with events of the what is called the great ones of the history. But moving on and coming back to 1859, we had basically on the throne of the kingdom of Two Sicilies, Francis II, and Francis II only son of Maria Cristina, that he was facing his seven counts in Victor Emmanuel II. And Victor Emmanuel II, son of Carlo Alberto, that were the cousins that have inherited the kingdom of the father of Maria Cristina, or let me say the grandfather of Francis II, because they were not able to inherit this kingdom for the European disposition, and so basically a seven cousin inherited the kingdom of Sardinia. But this seven cousin, of course, apart to be seven cousin, didn't have any other strict bond with the other princes, and so in 1855 he decided to invade the other states, and so he started, without a declaration of war, something that was considered very ultra-jus at the time, invaded the other states and basically put the foundation of a huge upheaval of the Italian status. So the king of Piedmont, Victor Emmanuel II, the Count of Cavour, his prime minister, and the revolutionary Giuseppe Garibaldi, they planned what is called royal conquest. They planned the royal invasion and conquest of the other states of Italy. Facing this conquest, the only princes that were able to basically to show their strength were, of course, again, the King of Naples, only 23 years old, and his wife, Maria Sofia, only 18 years old. They were passed to the history as the heroes of Gaeta, because, as we can see very soon, they faced a long siege in the fortress of Gaeta. But coming back to the royal conquest, in 1860, after having invited also the small states in the north, the army of Piedmont, supported by this basically army of revolutionary led by Garibaldi, they invited the kingdom of the south, starting from Sicily and slowly going up to Naples, the capital. The king and the queen decided, badly advised, to save the capital from the bombing, and so they decided to move the army to the fortress of Gaeta, that was more or less in this position, to stay and to wait for a reaction also from the other European nations. And so they faced what was called the Siege of Gaeta, that ended in 13th February 1861, after 6 months of the siege, in what is called the Fall of Gaeta. The young king and the young queen stayed in that castle without the advices of everybody that was asking from the other European court to put their life in safe, but they wanted to stay until the last day was possible. So the 13th February, basically, of 1861, they were forced to accept the capitulation of the fortress. They had to surrender, and so they left the fortress in the same moment, basically, or more or less in the same days, in Turin. A parliament of the Piemont was proclaiming Victor Emmanuel King of Italy. And pay attention, a parliament of Piemont, not the parliament of Italy. They basically just proclaimed their king as king of the new conquered states. And so after this, as I said before, started a big season of upheavals through all the territory, and what we call the Piemontesization of the Italy. Basically, the first symbol, symbolic basically sign of this was that the king, becoming king of Italy, decided to not change his number. The number is very important in royalties because he represents the number of kings that ruled the same state. And so Victor Emmanuel II, king of this name in Piemont, he wanted to keep his number, also becoming king of Italy, representing that he was not founding a new state, but he was just enlarging the borders of his old states. So this was the first symbolic act of what we will be become the Piemontesization of the states. Then they forced the constitution of Piemont to all Italy, ignoring all the first system of codes and laws that were present in all the territory, as well as all the promises of autonomy and decolonization of the power that they did during the War of Conquest were totally ignored. But it was not only this. They annulled all the international commerce treaties between the seven states and the previous, basically, their usual commercial partner in Europe, as also in the old world. They suppressed all the advanced civil codes and law systems from two Sicilies and Tuscany that were totally overwhelmed by the Piedmont codes. Also the education and university system was founded in that states for centuries. They were totally overwritten by Piedmont traditions. They deleted also the welfare system of Tuscany, of the duchies of the center of Italy and the two Sicilies. The Piedmont didn't have at all a welfare system, and they suppressed all the welfare system of these most advanced states. And I remember that in Europe, in the 1860, there were very limited states that have welfare system, and probably in Italy they were more advanced, but their welfare tradition was totally destroyed. As well also in the economy, the Piedmont forced the two Sicilies treasure to pay in full all the public debt of Piedmont. That was a huge debt. They imposed their inflated currency, the lira, on Tuscany and Sicily, that instead were belonging strong currencies. Piedmont officers were sent to cover all the public offices through the new country. And Piedmont workers were being paid double than what they called the new Italians. Anti-clerical regulations were also issued by the new government against all the traditions and the people's belief, above all from the south of Italy and the Tuscany. So this didn't happen without a tentative, at least, of rebellion, because in the same years, between 1861 and 1870, we had in the south what was also called as War of the Cafoni, or War of the Peasants. Basically, these people working the land, farming the land, in the south of Italy, they got rebelling. So they made a big rebellion, huge numbers of small fightings with the Italian army for 10 years that created what was the civil war, actually, in the south of Italy. This war was characterized by the loyalty of these people to the king, the loyalty to the church, and also to many severe impositions on the peasants that they received, as like the military service for 2 years mandatory, and the taxes that, as I told you before, were the first time in the south of in the history of the south that were imposed on the people farming the lands, as well as the sequestration of public lands to sell and to get other money for the government that was in need of money to pay all their expenses for the War of Conquest. And you can imagine that these rebellers were so determined that they forced the government to send half of the Italian army, 120,000 soldiers, against 80,000 rebellers. At the end, they counted 8,000 dead from the army versus between 20,000 and 50,000 dead from the peasants. Of course, we will never know the very numbers, but what I can tell you is that many of the prisoners were brought on the Alps, on the mountains in the north, and very basically peak on the mountains, and in this old fortress where basically they were forced to stay in prison, where the soldiers used to break the glass of the windows to get stay them in more colder weather, and most of them died for the winter season, also because they were from the south of Italy. They were never experienced in their life so cold weather before. But in 1871, with the conquest of Rome from the north of Italy, from and with the holiness Pius IX, that basically closed himself within the Vatican walls, declaring prisoners of the new kingdom of Italy, we have the ends of this rebellion. And so all the territory now belongs to the new king of Italy. The church, the holy site, is basically in fights. At the time, was in fights with the government and excommunicated of the government. And the Pope never left the Vatican walls until the 1920s, after an agreement that basically they took 50 years to arrive to this agreement. So you can imagine. Also, the Pope issued an order called in Latin non expedit, where basically it was forbidding to all the Italian people to attend the public life in this new kingdom built on the deceive and the invasion and the blood of the brothers. So, coming back to the last important point that I want to share with you, that destroyed and put the basis for the immigration to the United States, was the industrial politics of the new kingdom. Because they made their best to focus all the investment for the industry to the north of the country, to have a strong relationship with France, Germany, and Belgium, historical partners of Piemont, and they totally neglected the Mediterranean countries that were still the strength of the Two Sicilies economy, as well as the Austrian Empire, pillar of the Venice economy. And so they destroy all the industrial achievement in the south of Italy, forced them to be just basically a supply of agricultural food of the industrial triangle of Turin, Genoa, and Milan. And so Venice, Tuscany, and Two Sicilies were relegated to a role of agricultural system, agricultural basically producers. And this split the country dangerously in two parts, so under two different economies, the north very industrialized and the south totally devoted to the agricultural. And this put the basis for a big instability, because only after a few years happened a huge crisis in Europe that was called the Great Depression. And this basically destroyed the agricultural system. And so you can imagine that in Italy, with this huge split between the two economies, so a natural split, put the South in a huge crisis. So, but let's move just a few years back in the United States to understand what was happening there. United States, after the Civil War, the Congress started to issue the Homestead Acts to give for free small lot of lands to new settlers. And so a lot of people from north of Italy, like Sweden or Norway or also North Germany, they moved to the United States to take these free lands. And so in the state of the center of United States, they started to farm these lands for the first time after thousands of years. This regulation from the Congress brought the farmers from 10 million to 30 million. And of course, this created a huge quantity of corn, a huge quantity of wheat, a surplus in the United States that, of course, this surplus had to come back somewhere else. And so it came back to Europe. And arriving this surplus of corn, of wheat in the Europe, this basically generated what I call it before the Great Depression, between 1875 and 1895. This was due because this surplus of wheat, of corn, arriving and Europe destroyed the price of the corn and the wheat in Europe. Destroying this price, all the system founding of an agricultural income of estates was totally destroyed. And so the nobility of Europe that have a lot of big estates, as well also the farmers and the peasants, were destroyed. And so you can imagine how this basically impacted Italy. Because the south of Italy, that was at this point totally devoted to agriculture, was totally destroyed. And so after this, from Europe and above all the south of Italy, we started to see a huge wave of immigrants to the United States. As well as the governors of Europe started to attack and to colonize Africa and Asia to find new markets for their industry that were, of course, without any more customer because the customer were in crisis for the Great Depression. But this was actually, if I want to say the truth, this was enough to collapse very quickly the South economy that was still strong in some way because they have still this inheritance from the past kingdom. But the problem is that after this Great Depression, in accordance with the crisis of the agriculture, we starting to have a lot of riots through all the countries. In Milan, we have a famous rebellion that was suffocated in the blood by the army. This arrived to basically this rebellion arrived to kill the king of Italy, Umberto the First, in 1900s by an anarchic Italian anarchic coming from Paterson in New Jersey that shot to the king during a parade in Monza. And this basically, we had other strikes, social protests. The system creating by the unification of Italy was collapsing, and so also the government with the other European government started to think that only a war could have saved the situation. And this is what also basically led the Europe to the First World War. But in the same time, in Naples in 1906, we had the last huge eruption of the Vesuvius that basically created in one few basically days 150,000 people, refugees, escaping from the area around the volcano. This creating a huge crisis again in Italy that also had to renounce to hoist the Olympic Games in 1908. So you can imagine that after this, after the collapse of the economy, the agricultural, all the crisis generated also this eruption of Vesuvius, and so basically this blessed, let me say, the second wave of the emigration to Americas from 1901 to 1915. This emigration was stopped, of course, by the war, the First World War, that as also for the willing of the people that wanted, for the states that looked for this war, basically changed the economy in Europe, and so also after this all the situation started to be totally different, and so the country that won the war starting to have, like Italy for example, another basically status of condition that in any case this brought slowly also to the Second World War, but this is another story, of course. And the last thing that I want to share with you, that between these families that left the Italy, there was also my family, actually a piece of my family, because my great-great-grandfather Vincenzo, with a piece of his family, because also this was happening, many families were split in two. So in this case, my ancestor Vincenzo took some of his children and they left for Boston. So they arrived in Boston in United States and they basically put all their hopes for a new life. When basically other three children of Vincenzo, including my ancestor Antonino, remained in Naples and they kept the hope to basically to not have to leave their roots and their origins. But the reality is that a lot of people suffered from this emigration. This helped in some way to create probably the Italy that was never created so far. And so it started also to create a common feeling about the people in Italy, about these pains, this sorrow for the people that have left and they cannot come back because they were not the economic condition to allow this. And they were going to the new world where basically was not new, because it was new lands, because they were very old lands, of course, but was new because they were giving the hope, at least, of a new life. Hope that sometimes brought to a real good future, sometimes probably to a future that would have been better in Naples, but they didn't know this, of course, and so they just wanted to try a second opportunity in their lives. So basically, this is the story that I wanted to share with you, And so I think that I hope that you enjoyed this small and quick summary of the Italian history between the immigration to the United States. And I thanks all of you that have the attention to follow my presentation. And whatever you want to go a little bit in details, you can buy this booklet also on the website lulu.com, lulu.com. And in any case, you can contact me in any moment also on YouTube, and I will answer to your questions. This video was also done, I would say, was mainly done for my lost relatives, because what I have not yet told you, that after 110 years, I found my relatives that went to United States. And so for me, this is a big, important point of my life, because I never thought that I would have been to find all these lost relatives. And so I'm very happy, and I dedicate to them this video, and so the story that I told you. Thank you very much, and see you soon.